Welcome to the old Schwamm Mill in Arlington, Massachusetts. There have been mills on the brook here in Arlington since the year 1637. Early mills ground the grain and sawed the lumber of the colonists. As Massachusetts entered the Industrial Revolution, mills for the making of tools, clothing, chemicals, and cabinetry were established. In 1864, two German immigrants, Charles and Frederick Schwamm, purchased the spice mill on this location and converted it into a woodworking mill. Their product was oval picture frames, which became popular for portraits after the Civil War. The mill operated as a family business for 100 years, with five generations of Schwamms taking part. In that time, it witnessed the evolution of industrial power from water wheels to steam engines to electricity. It saw waves of immigrant workers come to America's shores, and it experienced both prosperity and hardship in the economy. Today, the Schwamm Mill is a living museum, still making hand-turned frames for customers who want historically authentic craftsmanship. Please join us for a look into American manufacturing history.
Up my clothes. I ain't gonna work in the factory and splinters in my toes. Pity me, my darling, pity me, I say. Pity me, my darling, and carry my blues away. And greasy up my clothes. I ain't gonna work in the factory and splinters in my toes. Pity me, my darling, pity me, I say. Pity me, my darling, and carry my blues. And carry my
at the mill turns around of its own free will, with a hand in the hopper and the other in the sack. Ladies step forward and the gents fall back.
Down flew an owl with his head all white, lonesome day and a lonesome night. But I heard a pretty girl say, you court all night and you sleep all day.
Same old man working at the mill turns around of its own free will, with a hand in the hopper and the other in the sack. Ladies step forward and the gents fall back.
Well,
with a hand in the hopper and the other in the sack.
one of the first steps in making a picture frame is sawing out the four quadrants or the four sections that comprise the frame. And here's an example of one in my hand right here. And you can see that basically it's a curved arc of wood. And we use a bandsaw to cut these curved lines. And the bandsaw makes that possible because of the nature of its blade, which is very narrow and very shallow from front to back. And it's an endless band of metal with numerous sharp teeth on the front. And as I mentioned, because it's so narrow and so shallow, it can cut curves like this. So that's what we do. We trace around. We have a pattern that we lay on the appropriate rough lumber. We trace the outline of the pattern onto the rough lumber. And then by using that special type of blade that the bandsaw has, it's possible for us to saw out the four quadrants that make up the frame. The next step in making a picture frame, once you have cut out the four quadrants, is to refine the ends of those quadrants. Most specifically, the two ends of the quadrant have to be exactly 90 degrees to one another, and all four of the quadrants have to be exactly the same in terms of overall length. So the problem that the Schwamms had to solve was, how can you cut this end exactly 90 degrees to this end and then go ahead and do three more and have all four of them end up being exactly the same as one another? And they solved that by using a sliding table saw. And on top of the sliding table portion of the table saw, there are two positioning jigs. There's one on the left-hand side and one on the right-hand side, that is, as you're looking at it when you're running the machine. They permit you to lock these pieces into place and then push the entire table, including your section, forward away from you, past the edge of the saw blade. The blade stays still, although it's revolving. The whole table and the quadrant get pushed past it, and the end gets sawed off, and then you shift the quadrant over to the other side of this sliding table and to the other positioning jig, which is also very carefully adjusted, and you make that second cut by holding the piece kind of locked into position on the table, and the table gets pushed forward. The second cut will be exactly perpendicular to the first, and this becomes particularly critical when you consider the next step, which is to put them all together. If the angles are not exactly 90 degrees and you put all four pieces together, three of them will look very good, and the fourth one will have some kind of a gap or a pie-shaped missing kind of a wedge or something that's, you know, irregular. Let's see, we're up to step number three in the assembly of a rough picture frame. And now what we want to do is to create a very strong joint between all four of the sections that comprise the frame. And what the Schwamms have decided to do and what we have continued to do is to use a type of a joint that's known as a finger joint. Now here's an example of what a finger joint, or what fingers look like, I should say. And as you can see, they're comprised of fingers and then little spaces in between them. And the spaces are exactly the same thickness as the fingers. And that permits you to slide the two, if I can find the right way to do it, to slide the two opposing pieces together just like that. And as you can see, they overlap or intertwine, however you want to explain it. But there's a lot of surface area. And when you put glue, put the glue on there and then slide them together, all the surface area and all the interweaving or interlocking creates a very strong joint. And that's what you want, because obviously when you've finally done the turning, a lot of the wood has been removed, the cross section has been lessened, but you need to have something that's very strong and very stable. And that's what, in part, that's what the finger joint helps you to accomplish. Now, the machine itself is comprised of an arbor with, maybe 10 identical saw blades spaced exactly the same distance apart from each other on the arbor. And when you slide your quadrant through, and if you follow the correct procedure, you will create four sections of your frame that, when laid down on a flat surface, will slide together, the fingers will interlock, and that's what you want to do. And that's what the groover permits you to do. So far, we've gotten all four sections of our frame ready to be glued together. And upstairs here at the mill, there is a specific room that's called the glue room. And in it are numerous stations that each station of which is basically comprised of a flexible strip of metal. And essentially what happens is that you paint glue on the fingers or the finger joints of your four sections, you slide them together, and you wrap the flexible metal strap around it, and then crank the hand wheel. The metal strap will then conform to the shape of your frame and squeeze with equal pressure from all the way around the outside of the frame. This flexible metal clamp is really a great solution to the problem. The type of glue that the Schwamms used here was what is known as hide glue. Hide glue is derived from either the bones or the cartilage of horses, most usually, I believe. And when it arrives here at the mill, it comes as a granulated, not quite a powder, but sort of a granular substance. When this hide glue, when the hide glue granules are mixed with hot water, they dissolve, and that is what the Schwamms used as their glue. It's a very well-known older style of glue, and it actually is very strong. And if you look around the glue room, you'll notice that there's glue, hardened glue everywhere. It's a kind of a sloppy procedure, but you need to make sure you really get the glue into all the ins and outs of every finger joint. And you brush it on there, and obviously a lot of it will run off, but that's okay. You need to really make sure that it's thoroughly applied. And that's how we do it. Of course, these days we could still use hide glue, but we use something that is sort of derived, at least historically speaking, it's sort of a derivation of hide glue, I believe. And that's what we use usually these days, is tight bond. After the frames are glued together and the glue has hardened, which these days means that I normally wait overnight, what you find almost always is that glue has squeezed out of the finger joints. What this does is leaves a very uneven, kind of messy surface at each one of the finger joints. So what we have to do before we mount the rough frames on the lathe for turning is we need to level off at least one side of the rough frame. And to do that, what I normally use is the large jointer. Now the jointer has a 2 foot wide blade on it, I believe, and a 2 foot wide infeed table as well. And essentially what you do is you set the infeed table at a very slightly lower elevation than the outfeed table, if that's the correct terminology. It may not be, but you lower the infeed table just a tiny little bit and lay the rough frame on it, and using a kind of protective pushing device, of which we have 4 or 5 varying sizes, which not only sort of push the frame across the blade, but also keep your hands a reasonable distance away from the blade during the process. With the blade spinning towards you and you pushing the rough frame into the blade, what happens is that the jointer knives will just slice off maybe a 32nd of an inch off the bottom of the rough frame. And you can adjust the amount of cut per pass, so that what you do ultimately is you not only cut off the irregular surface that the hardened glue left behind, but you also level off the what will most likely become the back side of the frame. And that's important because the next step is to turn the frame, and you want to have a really flat, true surface to work off of.
The Schwamm Mill was founded in 1864 by Charles and Frederick Schwamm, 2 of 6 Schwamm brothers who left Germany between 1837 and 1857. Starting in the 1790s, large-scale German emigration was driven by a rapidly expanding population, invasions by France, and domestic revolts. The greatest number of emigrants came from the wine country of southwestern Germany. The Schwamm brothers coming from the Duchy of Rhine-Hessen. The first Schwamm woodworking enterprise was established in 1850 by Charles. When brothers Peter and Theodore came to America, they apprenticed with Charles and their eldest brother Jacob. Theodore and Jacob would later go on to start their own mills, while Charles would form his oval frame partnership with Frederick. Frederick left the Boston area in 1867, eventually settling in Chicago. Charles bought out his brother, and the business became known as the Charles Schwamm Company. Charles's son, Carl William, was made a partner in 1875 as the company prospered and became known as Charles Schwamm and Son. Day-to-day operation of the mill was in the hands of foreman John Bitzer, another German immigrant. In 1903, Charles Schwamm died, and by this time, the business had declined. In 1905, Carl William chose to retire, and his sons, Clinton and Lewis, took over the firm. They rebuilt sales from almost nothing and reincorporated as Clinton W. Schwamm & Company. In the 1920s, Clinton brought his son Elmer into the business, and the three ran the factory into the 1960s. By that time, Elmer's teenage son Wayne also worked in the mill. In 1967, Lewis died, followed by his brother Clinton the next year. Elmer, at age 63, was ready to retire, and the business was struggling again. In 1969, Elmer closed the shop, and the family era of the Schwamm Mill came to an end.
The next stage in making a frame here at the old Schwamm Mill is the actual turning of the frame on the elliptical lathe. Assuming that you have adjusted it so that it will create the longer axis versus the correct shorter axis, the next stage is to mount the frame on the lathe. And basically, without going into a lot of detail, you have to sort of center your rough frame on the faceplate of the lathe and then screw into it from behind, that is from the other side of the faceplate. Four screws come through the back side of the faceplate into the back side of your frame. You engage the elliptical faceplate lathe, you turn it on by grabbing the shifter lever, which basically slides a leather belt from the idler pulley to the drive pulley for that particular lathe. And that causes the lathe to start to spin around. Now, what you do is you hold your chisels and carefully push them in against the wood. Now, in order to kind of counterbalance the downward pressure of the wood on the tip of your chisel, you have a very heavy cast iron tool rest, which is at a very precise elevation, so that when you lay your lathe chisel down on top of the tool rest, the very top of the chisel is at exactly the halfway or the kind of median elevation, horizontal elevation. And what this, that's important because if you are lower than that or higher than that, you'll turn out a sort of a skewed version of the oval that you're really trying to carve. So, if the tool rest is at the right elevation and the lathe is adjusted correctly and your frame is securely screwed onto the faceplate of the lathe, you can start to actually do the wood turning. Now, what I normally do is take a pencil and by revolving the lathe by hand on the very front of the rough frame, I will gently trace out the inner and outer parameters of that frame that I'm about to turn. And then when I turn the lathe on, I can kind of see these two lines and they give me fairly accurate guidelines to shoot for in terms of initially roughing out the initial turning so that I have the outer outline of the frame and then the sight line of the frame on the inside. So, you know, you have to kind of adjust the tool rest so that you can work on the outside of the frame and then readjust it so you can work on the inside of the frame. And you have to be careful, particularly at these early stages, because both the outside of the frame and the inside of the frame are very likely to be irregular, so that there may be a bump someplace out there because you sawed them out on the bandsaw and glued them together as a rough frame, and it's not smooth, and consequently the wood being irregular can grab the chisel, particularly at this early stage of the game. So you have to be very careful and kind of ease your way in and take your time and carve off all that rough stuff on the outside and the inside of the wooden frame, and then gradually refine the outer and inner lines of the frame. Then I typically also will run across the front of the frame and just level it off, because that as well is usually slightly irregular. And at this stage of the game, what you also are trying to do is to get the proper thickness of the frame. Now, in this little piece that I'm holding right here, which is sort of the what I was shooting for in this particular lathe demonstration, when I say the the outside of the frame, that would be this line here. This would be the inside, and this distance from here to here would be the thickness of it. So at this stage of the game, in the description I've given, it's just going to be roughed out so that this line and this line and this elevation have been sort of squared up. And it's just going to be a square or rectangular refining at this stage of the game. The next step is to actually turn this little notch right here, which is on the inside of the frame. That's what's known as the rabbet. We have a special right angle turning tool which allows us to accomplish this type of turning. And when you look at the video, you can see why you need something different than a regular straight lathe chisel to do this. So we use the right angle turning tool and bring it in and then come in sort of perpendicular or sideways and cut the rabbet out. Then you actually move on to what may be the more interesting part of the turning, and that is carving the profile of the frame into this rough frame that's on the lathe. The profile is the curves and the beads and the coves and the little edges and landings. So, you know, you may use several different chisels during this process. You may just use a regular skew or a diamond tip chisel, but you might also need something with a nice little kind of a bead at the end of the chisel to cut little coves like this one has right here or right here. The chisels can be sharpened or have their shape refined perhaps, you know, numerous times during the course of turning a frame. And to do that, we do have a bench grinder, which is located only about 15 feet away from the lathe. But the net result is something, for example, like this. And, you know, this can be accomplished by working from a sample. But as you can see right here, the sample is slightly larger in terms of its cross-section or width than the actual frame. And that's very common. You know, it may very well be that somebody wants a frame, could want a frame like this, but maybe twice as large in terms of diameter and length. In that case, it might be appropriate to make everything slightly larger as well so that it just sort of hangs together aesthetically. But in any event, you do the turning, you get the rough frame turned to the shape and dimensions and profile that the customer has asked for. And then most usually, while it is still on the lathe, the newly turned frame will be refined and smoothed by going through several grits of sandpaper, starting possibly with 80 or 100 and working your way up to 220 at the finest, and just so you create a really nice, smooth, beautiful frame before you remove it from the lathe. But the only other thing I will say about that is that if it is going to be a natural wood finish or a natural finished wood frame where you can see the grain of the wood at the end, one of the things that Pat Fitzmaurice explained to me early on and that I will still do is to grab a handful of wood shavings off the floor and then press them firmly against the frame while it's revolving on the lathe, and that tends to burnish and bring up a little bit of natural shine or sort of glow in the wood before it even has any finish applied to it. And that pretty much sums up the steps of turning a frame on a lathe here at the Old Schwamm Mill.
Well, what's happening when you are turning an oval on the elliptical faceplate lathe is that the mechanism, which is not visible in these sequences but nonetheless is controlling all the action, is causing the frame to basically be either centered on one axis or on another axis, which is offset to the right, a distance that you predetermine. When you watch it run under these circumstances, where the chisel is located and where the tool rest is located, if you look at the frame there, it is tracking vertically straight down, which allows you to apply the chisel to the frame. If you look over to the right of center, you'll notice that there's a lot of blurry, rather dramatic action taking place, and that is because the frame is sliding over to the right twice per revolution and then sliding back over to the centered left position. And the consequence is that on the right, it looks very blurry, and that is because it is sliding back and forth and back and forth. But it is that sliding to the right and then back which creates the longer axis and then the shorter axis. Meanwhile, at the elevation of the tool rest plus the top of the chisel, the frame is tracking vertically straight down, and you can just do your scraping turning there, anywhere along that elevation to the left of center. And as far as the tool is concerned, the wood is just coming straight down over the tip of the chisel. Consequently, you can carve all of these infinite number of beautiful shapes into the wood and create an oval turning.
Besides oval frames, the Schwamms made straight molding, which was sold in bulk to frame shops who cut it up to make rectangular frames. This product was made on a molding machine. Over the decades, there was a series of molding machines in the shop, made by the S.A. Woods Company, the American Woodworking Company, and possibly others. The last molder here was an S.A. Woods Model 133, which was 11 feet long and weighed 5.5 tons. A molding machine uses metal knives to carve the wood. The blades are bolted to cutter heads, which rotate at high speed. The wood is automatically fed through the machine, and it passes by a series of these heads, one on the top, one on the bottom, and one on each side, so that all four surfaces of the lumber can be milled in a single pass. These machines were very versatile, with many possible adjustments. At the same time, they were very finicky, and they would not produce good results unless set up exactly right. Each frame shop had its own preferred molding patterns, and the Schwamms had hundreds of molder knives to cut them all. Part of the filing system is behind me. Each cubbyhole holds examples of frame profiles for one customer, as well as the knives used to make them. The mill no longer has a molding machine, so we paid a visit to Mark Brumell, the proprietor of Vintage Woodworks in Perryville, Maryland. Mark's shop is full of antique equipment like this self-feed ripsaw, identical to one the mill once had. But Mark also has an 1890s molder made by the S.A. Woods Company of Boston. We don't know exactly which molder the mill had at that time, but Mark's machine must be very similar. This molder is from the pre-electric era, and the moving parts are powered by belts coming off of a common shaft at the rear of the machine. Lumber is fed in from the right side, where it is grabbed by two ribbed rollers, which pinch the wood against a flat bed and push it forward. As the wood travels along the bed, it first encounters the top cutter head, then the outside cutter, the inside cutter, and the bottom cutter. And finally, it drops out of the machine on the left side. We brought a Schwamm knife to try on Mark's molder. For simplicity, we just used the top cutter head to carve the main profile, and we disconnected the belts for the other heads. While bolting the knife onto the cutter head, we traced its outline onto the end of a piece of wood to verify the position of the profile. Then we fired it up. And here it is, the first Schwamm molding in 44 years.
One of the first questions that visitors have about the Schwamm mill is how many people worked here, and the answer varies depending on the time period. When the mill started in 1864, there were 8 employees. 10 years later, there were more than 30. This was when the mill was at its height in terms of oval frame manufacturing. When the grandchildren Louis and Clinton took over the mill in 1904, the depressed business had only 6 or fewer workers per week, and the number of workers varied week to week. People came and went, and there were also part-time employees at this time. But by the 1920s, the business had increased again to the point where there were perhaps 12 workers on average every week, and this was the norm throughout the 20th century. Also of interest to visitors is where the workers lived. Many of the workers were from Arlington, and we know their names from the town directories. They lived in Arlington and sometimes went home for lunch. They tended, if they did live in town, to live closer to the mill. Within walking distance, say. The surrounding streets had private homes on them where people lived, or workers sometimes might board. But besides Arlington, there were also workers from all the surrounding communities, from Roslindale, Roxbury, Brighton, East Boston, and also from towns like Melrose, Cambridge, Medford, and Somerville. The employees needed here at the mill included the molder, who made the straight molding, the turners, who carved the profiles into the oval frames, people who'd put the frames together, gluing them, people who'd cut up the wood, the stock cutters, people who did shipping, and people who did transporting of wood from the dry house to the mill or from the yard to the dry house. There were also people who did shipping and sanding. Before the mill was fully electrified in the 1940s and 50s, the engineer was required to run the steam engine. He was salaried. And he worked from 7 in the morning until the close of the mill when he shut the engine down. There were also frame finishers here at different times. The earliest newspaper accounts talk about the frames being varnished here, but we also see evidence all over the mill that there was whiting applied to frames, a smooth layer of gesso to prepare the frames for gold leaf. In addition, Elmer Schwamm ran a business on the third floor called Elwain, which purchased raw frames from the mill and finished them and sold them as completed products. How long was a work day at the mill? In 19th century Arlington, according to the Massachusetts Industrial Census, a work day at most factories and places of business in Arlington was 10.5 hours in the summer and perhaps 10 or 9.5 hours in the winter when there was less daylight. By the late 19th century, the norm was 10. In the early 20th century, a 9.5 hour workday was typical, and you'd also be expected to work Saturdays. In the 1920s, the full-time norm was down to 9 hours. It was also typical to work full Saturdays in the 20s, and really throughout the 19th and 20th centuries. Employees at the Schwamm mill got about the same number of holidays that we get today, but they were not paid holidays, except for possibly Christmas. Another common question is how much people were paid here, and which jobs were skilled and which were not. The best pay records we have are from the early 20th century, the 19-teens and 20s, consisting of weekly time books and also accident reports which had to report a worker's pay. The highest paid men were Clinton Schwamm, the owner and executive, and his brother Louis Schwamm, who was the shop foreman. Clinton's salary was $35 a week, although he sometimes took less when business was slow. The next highest paid employees were the molder and the engineer. The molder made at least as much as the shop foreman, $20 a week, say, for 57 hours of work. In 2011 dollars, that would be an equivalent of about $460 a week. The engineer, who was salaried, made $15 a week. Other people, such as the turners, would make about half what the molder made. And there were people who were paid less, people who did shipping or very ordinary woodworking. For a short time in the 1860s and 1870s, the mill was crowded with 30 or more workers doing every stage of frame production. The echoes of that period are all over the walls of the mill in the form of whiting and varnish traces and workers' graffiti. But for the most part, and for the most of the mill's history, it was a smaller business with one or two family members in charge, two or three long-term employees handling key jobs, and 8 to 10 workers, mostly young single men, working a year or two on basic parts of frame making.
First of all, let me just shake your hand. Mr. Roach.
Jim.
Jim Roach.
Jim.
Jim Roach, it's really great to have you come back here to the old Schwamm Mill. I do the woodworking here now, but it's my understanding that you did a lot of woodworking here some years ago, and we're really looking forward to a chance to talk with you and have you share your memories and just perceptions of the way it was and the way it is now. And could we just... Could you just tell me what year you came to work here?
57, June of 57.
June of 57.
Right.
That's quite an accurate memory you have there.
Oh, I remember well, because I arrived on Memorial Day of 57, and I remember all the cemeteries had all the little flags, the American flags out, and I asked my aunt and uncle who picked me up at Logan, what was it all about? And she said, well, today's Memorial Day. So, we proceeded to my first cousin's house in Revere and had my first meal of spaghetti and meatballs.
Yeah.
I didn't know which end was up. But
So June of 57 is when you first came to the United States.
That's right, yes.
And how old were you then?
19.
Mm-hmm. And then you came to work at the old Schwamm Mill?
I started looking at the newspaper, and I found an ad looking for a woodworker.
Mm-hmm.
And my uncle, because I wasn't driving then, not yet anyway, so my uncle took me up for an interview, and I got hired.
Yeah, had you been doing woodworking before you came?
Actually, I left two jobs to come here.
You did?
I had two jobs back home. I was a coach builder.
Oh, really?
Apprentice coach builder. Yeah,
horse
I used to build cartwheels and
really
all that. Oh, yeah.
That's a very demanding type of woodworking.
It was pretty hard.
Yes.
But that's what I did before I emigrated. Yeah.
So coming from that type of background with some very particular type of demands in the woodworking, what was your impression of the old Schwamm Mill when you came in?
Oh, I loved it. I fit right in like a glove.
Yeah?
Oh, yeah, because I could handle anything they gave me.
I'm sure you could.
I did everything from loading the kilns to French polishing and wrapping it up and calling the Federal Express to come take it away.
Yeah?
Yeah. Yeah. Hmm.
So was there one particular job that they gave you at first, or were you always sort of a jack of all trades?
I was. They put me anywhere they needed.
At that particular day.
Yeah. That's right. Yeah. Hmm. Whether it was on the shaper or turning here or cutting the segments or whatever it was, or upstairs gluing up.
Yeah.
Didn't matter. I did it all.
How many other employees were there here at that time?
There were about seven. I would say about seven at that time. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Of all ages? Were there any younger?
There was only one close to my age, and he was from Amsterdam, Rudy LeCruve. He did finishing. Hmm. And the rest of the fellows were probably in their 50s and 60s.
Hmm.
Yeah, from Melrose, Malden, and Wilmington, and Gordon Richardson from Arlington. And
would you say they had been employed here for a number of years
already?
They had
been here for a long time, yes, yes. Yeah, and Elmer was my direct boss. He told me what to do.
Would you mind just sort of giving us your recollections of all the steps of making a picture frame as you recall them?
Sure. Well, we would get a truckload of basswood in, and it would be just air dried, and the first thing we had to do was dry it. So across the street was a dry kiln.
Mm-hmm.
So myself and Warren from Nova Scotia, He was the fireman. We would load the kiln and stick all the wood, and he would take charge of drying it, and then maybe 3 to 4 weeks later, we'd unload it. And then we would bring maybe a couple of hundred feet into the shop, mm-hmm. and I would have an order for some oval frames, and I would just cross-cut lengths of rough stock mm-hmm. for the frames, mm-hmm. and take them then to the shaper, to the joiner, to flatten them, mm-hmm. and then to the thickness planer to plane them to thickness. And so then, after the thickness, rough thickness, we took them over to the bandsaw and marked them out mm-hmm. and nested them and cut them out in the bandsaw, mm-hmm. Oversized.
Right.
And then we took them to the cut off the table saw and cut them to size, net size, each quadrant. And
did you use the disc sander to touch them up if you had to, just to make them really go together before you actually
no,
put the finger joints?
No, never. Always
you
right from the saw.
Really?
I never did that.
You're a better man than I am.
No, we got it right on.
That's wonderful.
Yep. But, you know, it took about 15 minutes to get it right on. So then we took them and took them over to the groover mm-hmm. and grooved them.
Yep.
And then we
you
took
had a certain kind of procedure for that, so you could be sure that they would.
Well, left and right. Right. Yeah, you work from the left side and the right side.
Right.
I don't know how I remember all this, but I'm amazing myself here.
It's wonderful that you do remember it all so clearly.
So then we took them upstairs, not by the elevator. We walked up the stairs with the pieces
to
the glue room,
mm-hmm.
and there we. Laid them there for 2 or 3 hours before we glued them, so they would warm up to room temp.
Was the glue room particularly warm because of all that double boiler action up there?
It was very hot.
Hot.
Because with all the pipes mm-hmm. that were hot, and Elmer or Louis or Clinton would not allow the windows to be opened even a half an inch.
Really?
Even in midsummer, when it was well over, I would say, 110 degrees up there. And they didn't want any kind of a breeze cooling off the glue. We moved very fast.
Yeah.
Put the glue on, get it in there, tighten it up, and keep moving.
Yeah.
And that was a sweat box.
Boy, 110 degrees.
Yeah.
Oh, boy.
We'd leave them in overnight, and next morning we'd unclamp them and take them downstairs. And we would take them on the joiner and face them on the joiner.
Right. Clean off all the excess glue.
Clean off the extra glue. Mm-hmm. That's right. Scrape it off. So after we would flatten them, then we would take them over here to the eccentric lathe
mm-hmm.
and locate them and screw them on from the backside.
So you'd, the crosshairs were drawn on the
on the
wooden faceplate.
So it was, you just have to locate the frame and get it centered as possible.
Exactly, yeah. But then, you know, what the other thing that's crucial about that is that you have to know where to put those screws.
Screws,
so
yes.
So that you wouldn't want the screw like way down here in the bottom of this cove.
No, and you wouldn't want it in the rabbit either, because would be disastrous.
Yes.
Because you wouldn't want the screw to hit your knife, your knife when you're cutting.
Well, the other thing that you, of course, are familiar with, but other people might not be, is that there is no indicator dial or setting dial on the back of these lathes.
No.
So you need to figure out some way to get it adjusted so it will yield.
So it's doing the right size oval,
exactly.
Like 12 by 16 or
right.
20 by 16. And the slide, you have to adjust the slide depending on the size of the oval, and it takes a little bit to get that right.
Let's just use this frame as an example.
Yes.
Once you had it mounted on the faceplate, just, you know, roughly speaking, how long would you think it would take to turn?
I would say about an hour and a half.
And that's from starting from the rough frame.
Once it's on the board, until the ascent, about an hour and a half.
And that's working in basswood, most likely.
That's right.
And that's the turning process.
Yes.
After the Schwamm Mill, Jim Roach went on to work at other wood shops in Arlington, Boston, and West Newton. He also served in the National Guard and taught vocational school. In 1979, he founded his own architectural millwork business, the American Milling Company, from which he retired in 2012.
The 1960s was a time of transition for the Schwamm picture frame manufactory. Elmer Schwamm, the descendant who was running the mill at the time, could not keep it going. It had not been a profitable enterprise for a number of years, and in 1969 decided to sell the business to the Lawson brothers, a local trucking firm, who was going to demolish the mill and use it for parking. About the same time, the Arlington Garden Club, in conjunction with the Conservation Commission here in Arlington, was doing a survey of Mill Brook. One of the members was Patricia Fitzmaurice. When she saw the mill for the first time, she immediately fell in love with it and realized that this was a hidden gem in town that needed preservation. A woman of action, she brought together several of her friends to develop a plan for saving the mill. Dave Wallace, an architect, Rudy Cass, a lawyer, Doris Atwater, a fellow Garden Club member, and Augusta Hornblower, a Boston Brahmin, were brought into this tight group. In September 1969, over the course of the Labor Day weekend, Rudy Cass drafted the trust agreement and they executed it, establishing on September 3rd the Schwamm Mill Preservation Trust. Pat and Dave and Rudy and Doris now worked on negotiating with both Elmer Schwamm and Harold Lawson to purchase the mill, the machinery, and the archives that was inside. In early January of 1970, the deal was done and the mill was purchased with Doris supplying the down payment for the mortgage. The Schwamm Mill Preservation Trust had purchased the old Schwamm Mill, and it was up and running. One of the first things the trustees did was appoint Pat Fitzmaurice, they were no fools, as the managing trustee. Her responsibility was to keep the preservation project going and to finance it. And so her first idea was to bring in some local artisans, potters, jewelry makers, and an eccentric viola da gamma maker, Richard Hart. They came in and set up their studios, gave demonstrations, and also offered classes. Patricia Fitzmaurice continued on as managing director from 1970 until her death in 2001. Her death was a very traumatic incident for all of the trustees. I can remember coming together afterwards, just not knowing how we could possibly see our way forward. And it was very difficult. Her loss, her energy, she was, as a single entity, doing the work of 10 people. And it was very hard to then to distribute that work amongst a greater number of people. For many years after her death, I would wake up having dreams and having seen her. And just recalling it, it gives me goosebumps because her blue eyes were something incredibly penetrating and wonderful. And I can remember vividly a dream where I was saying to her, I just don't see how we can keep going. And she, with a twinkle in her eyes, said, don't worry, it will all come out well. And it has.
Through 150 years, the perseverance of the Schwamm family and the vision of Patricia Fitzmaurice have saved a working example of the Industrial Revolution for 21st century America. Our factory may be modest in size, but the plant is fully functional. Charles and Frederick Schwamm would surely recognize the process by which the mill makes oval frames today. The Schwamms were involved in their community, and the modern mill is open to all. The public is invited to see frame making, and special technology tours are available to school groups. Music and film events are held on the shop floor, and local artists exhibit in the upstairs gallery. All this takes place amid the sights and smells of an authentic 1860s wood shop. As we look forward to the next 150 years, the Schwamm Mill will continue its mission of preservation, education, and outreach, and the traditional making of quality oval frames.